Good evening. This lecture will be Leilui Nishmat, Gavriel Ben Shirin, and Amnon Ben Sio. As you can see, there's food, courtesy of the family. Just one announcement. This next 3 weeks, I'm not going to be here. I'm going to Eretz Israel on Wednesday morning. I have lots of lectures and seminars there. I will be back February 4th. So it won't be a lecture on February 4th, but the following Monday we will be back. On my Tuesday lecture, we're only going to miss 2 weeks. Next Tuesday and the one after, and then we'll be back there. So just that you know. Okay. One more announcement before I forget. My very dear friend, Rav Binyamin Golan from the Beit Din of Queens, he did a wonderful job. He wrote a book. It's called Welcome to Judaism, as you can see. Very fancy book, nice, very superb pages with colors. This is a guide to basic Judaism. It's very good for all the goyim that ask me, how do I start to convert? What's my first step? Because we deal for many years with conversions of many righteous goyim that comes to us to pray, to convert, he basically, based on experience, he designed a special guide for all these goyim that can learn all the necessary step, what Judaism is about, what to do, how to start, what to start with. But it's not only for goyim. It's also for Jews that beginning to become Baalei Tshuva. Because the knowledge of the Jewish people today is zero. Just like the knowledge of the goyim is zero, the knowledge of the secular Jews in these days is zero. It's not like it used to be 40 years ago. 40 years ago, our parents, grandparents, even though they're not Shomer Shabbat, they're not religious, they went to religious school, they knew holidays, they knew what Shabbat is, they knew what the holidays is about. The Jewish people today, especially in America, in Europe, in Russia, they have no idea what Judaism is. They don't know anything. Most of them don't even know who was Noah, what was the flood, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, who their wives were, where they live. Simple things they don't know. They don't even know why we eat matzah for. So therefore, because the level of the Jewish people now it's at zero level, this is where they have to start. Just like you teach children, you teach them Aleph Bet. That's very good. It's not available yet. Just like my book, when you make it in China, it takes a long time until they print it, and it takes a long time until it comes on with a boat, over a month. So it will be at least a month until my book arrives and until this book arrives. Once it will arrive, Bezrat Hashem will arrange that you can order both books on my website and in few other places. I will announce when Bezrat Hashem it will be actual. We finish Parashat Bo. We finish the 10 plagues that HaKadosh Baruch Hu hit the Egyptians. You know, when we read it in the Torah, sometimes it looks to us, with the help of the Yetzer Hara, the help of the evil inclination, it looks to some of us like a fairy tale. Come on, what is this? In the movies, in Hollywood, they make all these things, all kinds of effects. You really believe there were billions of frogs? Do you really believe the whole Nile was all blood? You really believe all this hail fell, big hail fell from the sky? That's because of that, in today's generation, most of these plagues already happen in our days. I don't know if you're aware, but for instance, in India, there was a huge, huge river. All became blood. You can see it. People took pictures. They went. Everything became blood. Mamash, all red. Hail just falling all the time in the world, size of a tennis ball. They hold one tennis ball. They hold one ball of ice, size of a tennis ball. Broke all the glasses of all the cars. On the hood of the car, it has hundreds of dots. Why? It destroyed the car. This is hail. But big one, not small, tiny little balls.
Very serious one. If it falls on someone else, it can kill him. So this is another example. Grasshoppers. Even today they have it in Egypt. They come, billions of them. It looks like a black cloud. Billions of them land in the town. In less than an hour, now one leaf is left on the trees. They eat everything. We have it in our days. We see things like that. Attacks of bad animals, that they come in one shot. Floods, like the time of Noah. We see floods everywhere. Wow, unbelievable flood. So everything that you read in the Torah is happening even today. Frogs in China. They collected, there was massive amount of frogs. Someone sent me a week ago an email. Big, it looks like swimming pool, but 5 times bigger. You know this big swimming pool, Olympic one? 5 times bigger, full with billions of frogs. Billions. You cannot count how many are full, filling up these pools. Hard to believe where they got so many frogs. Why Hashem is doing it? To wake up the people to realize, no, it's not history, it's even today. Even today these things happen. You know, they asked the Chafetz Chaim 100 years ago. He lived in Radin, in Europe. So they asked the Chafetz Chaim, why in our days there are all these inventions? They started to invent television, movies. You know, there used to be two roles. Most of you are young, but there's some older people here that can tell you. The first movies, 60, 70 years ago, it used to be two big rolls, very big. And they had a tape. They pulled the tape into the other roll, two rolls. They go around it, they press a button, and it begins to roll. And every 5 minutes, it gets stuck. It gets stuck, he has to fix it. People were cursing him in a cinema. This is how it was, and the quality was horrible. Most of them were black and white. The audio was terrible. This is how it started. He asked the Chafetz Chaim, why in our days you have recording, radio, radio waves, radar, and now you have video? Why? So the Chafetz Chaim answered, everything Hashem does, not only does it for purpose, He does it in the right time. By Hashem, it's all about timing. You know, in life, the most important thing is timing. You buy a stock, and you sell a stock. You buy it in the right time. You sell it in the right time, you make millions. You buy it in the wrong time, and you sell it in the wrong time, you lose millions. Same transaction. It could be minutes difference, that's it. 10 minutes later, you already lost. 10 minutes earlier, you already lost. Has to be in life the right timing. You get married, it has to be the right timing. It's not enough the girl is good or the guy is good. If you're too young, both of you, you will mess it up. If you're too old, you already got used to be alone. It's very difficult now to share a room with someone else. It's all about timing. In a highway, with a car, it's all about timing. We went one Shabbat, about 2 months ago, to Englewood for Shabbaton, the whole family in a car. I was driving, and it was a matter of 1 second, maximum 2 seconds. I pass, and the car next to me lost control, hit the car behind me, both of them turn around like this, boom, massive accident. All the cars behind had to stop. They closed the highway. 2 cars are blocking the highway. I made it. If I would be 1 second later, we would have to spend Shabbat in the highway. 1 second. I saw in my mirror how the cars are flipping like this. A matter of a second. Everything is calculated by Hashem to a second or to a tenth of a second, and it's very, very precise. We have to understand that. So when Hashem decided to bring video into the world and recording device, what is it for? Why now? Why not 400 years ago? He could have done it many, many years ago. Why did he have to do it 70, 80 years ago? The Chafetz Chaim said, until now, when you told a person, one day we die and we stand in front of Hashem and we're all going to have a trial, just like you go to court, you have a trial, they show everything about you to the whole world. Everything will be heard. Sof davar hakol nishma. Everything will be heard in your trial. Et ha'elokim yira, fear God, ve'et mitzvotav shmor, ki ze kol ha'adam. Fear God, keep His commandment, because that's what the human being is all about. All. Nothing else. Just this. Everything else, it's not relevant and it's not important. You have a nice house, you don't have a nice house, nice car, not such a nice car. You don't have a car, you go on a bus, you're tall, you're short, you're pretty, you're not. It's all baloney. It's not important. You have billions or you have nothing to eat. Because this is going to be over in a second. Life is a blink of the eye. 80 years fly by night. You take a person before he die in a hospital. Go to the hospital, try. Someone 80 years old, 90 years old. Tell him, here is a pen and here is a piece of paper. Write to me your entire life, please. He won't even fill up 10 pages. 10 pages. 90 years of life. 10 pages. How much? How is he going to write? I was born here, I was diseased, I got married that age, this is my wife, this is my children got married, I got this job, then I had another job, and I had an accident, and I had the surgery, and this, and I was 2 months in the hospital, and I moved to this city, and then I got that job, and now I have grandchildren, and now I'm 90, and I'm in bed, and I have cancer, and I'm about to die. Not even 3 pages. That's it. Life like this, 90 years. Blink of the eye, the Gemara say, not me. Ha'olam hazeh keheref ayin. A blink of the eye. That's it. This blink of the eye, now you're going to have to analyze it for 1 year. 1 year mishpat. That's why we say Kaddish for 1 year. What is all these things? 1 year Kaddish for someone that passed. Now there's 1 year trial to the person that passed. He needs our help. That's why we help him in any way we can. We learn Torah for him. We do Yortzeit for him. We do Kaddish for him. We give tzedakah for him. Very important. So a person stands in front of Hashem. Back in time, every Jew knew it. Everyone. People were very, very worried to die. They were very nervous. Wow, what's going to be? Where I'm going? Chafetz Chaim said, today people begin to question the Torah with the effect of the university and all the wicked people. The poison of the goyim went into the brains and the hearts of almost every Jew in the world. All the atheists, all the kfira, the heresy, all the infidels around us, and all the luxurious lifestyle made a lot of Jewish people fall asleep. They live in a dream. They think that we came to be in this world and eat and enjoy the moment. They forgot about the purpose of life. So Hashem wants to prove to them, in case you think it's not possible that you're going to see your entire life retroactive, here is a recording device, a video. Look, this happened 20 years ago, this happened, everything is recorded. So if people can make it, needless to say that I have a recording by me, that I will show you every second of your life. Now people see it, they say, well, if we can make a recording device and a video, of course Hashem has the same thing. Why today we have all the audio recording? Why today we have lectures on YouTube and on website and on telephones? Why? Why so everything is recorded now? 100 years ago, there's no recording. Why? Because 100 years ago, the memory of the people was 100 times better than today. Because people did not see all day naked people, they did not hear all the heresy, they did not have to be dealing with so much nonsense in this life and learn secular study and all the stress and the pressure and all the movies and the people's minds was clean. There was no electric, no electronic. People came home 5, 6 o'clock, it's dark, they had a lamp. They were holding the lamp like this and learn all day. Gemara, Torah, Mishnah, there was nothing else to do. You come home 6 p.m. It's dark in your tent. You live in a place, barely you have light. You put some candles by the wall. You have a little bit light. You sit with your children over there. What? Give me one thing to do. One thing, what are you going to do? Play chess? Okay, you play chess one night, two nights, five nights. What else are you going to do? Play sheshbesh. No, play cards. Then what? There's nothing to do. It's not like today. He doesn't know what to do. Everyone is addicted to his phone. 7.5 billion people, 6 billion of them all day like this. Everywhere you go. Took over their life. No relationship anymore. No relationship with the kids. No relationship with the wife. No relationship with anyone. Everyone is here. Why? Because people cannot remember anything. If you don't believe me, when the lecture will finish in 1.5 hours at 10 o'clock, you walk out the door, ask each other, what do you remember from the lecture? If you remember 1 minute, I'll be very surprised. You know, I say to a lot of my students, Baruch Hashem, I train few very, very good speakers in Israel to make them speakers. I won't live forever. I'm not getting any younger. I want to have few people that take my place and speak in my style, because the other styles, the very soft style, nobody changed. You can hear 20 years nice compliments, you're going to stay the same. Someone has to shake you up and wake you up and show you what's going to be your end, because if you're not going to know what's going to be your end, how are you going to change? The language that people understand is, if you're going to go in red light, it's going to cost you $1,000 and 10 points. Oh, no, now I got it. If you tell a person, please don't go on red light. I know you're in a rush, but try not to go on red light. Yes, yes, I will try. 2 minutes later, you go 5 times in red light. You tell them, next time you go on red light, camera everywhere. $1,000 fine, 10 points, your insurance go 10 times more. Oh my God, okay. He gets the point. You tell the person, you can do whatever you want now. You can break Shabbat, you can drive in a car, you can smoke, you can watch television, you can watch dirty movies, you can eat non-kosher food, you can let your wife walk naked on the street. You can do whatever you want. There's no gun to your head yet. But in the end, when you see the movie, every second it will be paused. Let's analyze why you and your wife get in a car on Shabbat and drive. Let's see. Is it pikuach nefesh? Someone is dying? No. Where are you driving? To the beach. Are you allowed to be in a beach? A son of God, the holy nation, the chosen people, they can sit like naked people, like in a safari. The monkeys are naked. They don't care. They walk naked. They're not embarrassed from each other. Are you allowed to sit with a married woman, a mother of 4 children, naked in a beach in front of 10,000 Italians and Puerto Ricans and Arabs, and it doesn't kill you that every one of these lowlifes looking at your wife all day like this every week? Where is your head? You're a grandson of Moshe Rabbeinu. Your grandfather in Bukhara, if you tell him put your wife on a beach like this with bikini, he will die 10 times before he will agree. You come and tell him, Mr. Gavrielov, Mr. Aminov, whatever, I want your wife to put this. What's this? This is underwear. No, no, it's not underwear. It's called bikini. Make her dress like this and go sit on the beach. Then 10,000 Puerto Ricans and Arabs and Italians and Chinese, all they will come and look at your wife. And we will give you $10,000 for it. And you know what? Even if he was greedy and he loved money, he would look at you like you are Adolf Hitler. That's what he would think about you, for offering him such a thing. Shame on you. Get out of my face. Don't ever come here anymore. And what happened to this guy? His grandson, that's what he does. And they show him in Shamayim, look at your children, look how they behave. Look what you left in the world. And they say, I wish I would not be born if I have such children. If I knew that my children would be going like this, I would rather not to be born and not to have children and not to live a minute. Such an embarrassment. Remember, over there, it's the world of truth. There's no illusions, there's no lies, nothing is fake. Olam ha'emet. Over here, the Gemara say, Alma de Shikra. Olam ha'sheker. Everything here is a lie. Everyone pretend, everyone put a show, every other word is a lie. In business, everyone lie and steal. In the court, everyone lie and steal. Witnesses lie, judges take bribe. Politicians are corrupted, everybody steal. We know that. We're not dumb. We understand where we live. This is a war zone. Over there, nobody can steal, nobody can lie, nobody can put a show. You can't fool God. You can fool everyone, even yourself. Most people fool themselves. They even fool themselves. How many people stay in business, force themselves to stay in a business, knowing they lose every year money, but they still stay in business? Another loan, and then another loan from the father-in-law, and a loan from the brother, and a loan from the mother, and a loan from a good friend, and a loan from a bank, and then cash advance, and then this, until he owes millions of dollars. That's what happened. Why? It's very hard for him to close the business and admit he failed. That business basically was losing money and not making money. People lie to themselves. People have pain. What's the right thing to do? Right away to make an appointment by the doctor, MRI, test to see, God forbid, maybe I have cancer, maybe I have ulcer, maybe I have Crohn's disease, thousands of diseases. Let's see what's my problem here. Most people avoid it. They don't go. Moshe, go to the doctor, I made you an appointment. No, no, I'm busy. He doesn't want to go. Why? He's afraid that the doctor will tell him his situation. This is smart or stupid? Smart person wants right away to know what's going on. Your tooth begins to hurt. Immediately you make an appointment. Now you don't wait even a week because you know filling is $100, $200. Root canal is $2,500. And it's a lot more painful. Then you need a crown. It's a big problem. Sometimes to take the tooth out. If you run quickly and fix it, you don't feel 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you close it, that's it. 20 years, you have rest. But people live in a lie. It will be fine. I still have time. There's no rush. When will I come to the doctor, 90% of the people, and it's already too late? That's it. That's what's going on here. So reality, we need recording today because people cannot remember anything. You need reminder, you need a diary, you need to write, everything you need to remind yourself. You can't remember anything. Back in time, if you see the memory that people had, the Gaon Mivilna 200 years ago, he wrote the whole Torah in reverse. 304,805 letters in reverse. Not from right to left, from left to right. Imagine you go to Torah, you go to the last word, the word Israel, you begin to write Lamed, Aleph, Resh, Shin, Yud, then you go to the word before, in reverse. We cannot write one sentence in reverse. If I tell you now a sentence, it will take you 2 hours to write it in reverse. Wait a minute, what comes first? 304,805 letters. The mind that the people had, you know, I remember when I went one time to Shabbaton in upstate, maybe 12 years ago, maybe 14 years ago, something like that. One of the hotels belongs to a religious Jew. We had Shabbaton in upstate. So they got a guy to read in the Torah, and this guy did not know how to read in the Torah. That was a very bad choice. So basically, almost in every word, he made a mistake. Almost in every word. He read Aliyat Kohen. Maybe he made 20, 30 mistakes. Every second you have to fix him. It's not pleasant. You feel bad for the guy. Why do you take the job when you don't know how to read? Okay? So then they say, Levi, Levi. There was no one from the people of the seminar Levi, but there was one Syrian old man in his 70s that he was Levi, and he came with his wife to the hotel for vacation. He had a little hat, small beard, maybe 75 years old. So they asked him, "You Levi, please." So he came out to the Torah and he started to read. Of course, with no preparation, no nothing, he read beautifully, no mistakes. When they saw such thing, we have such a Baal Koreh over here. Can you finish the whole parasha? Yeah? He finished the whole parasha, not one mistake. Without preparation. This is someone from the previous generation. That he learns in Syria Torah when he was a kid. by the Chachamim, the holy Chachamim and the Mekubalim of Haleb over there in Damascus. It's a different world than today. Then they called someone to read Haftarah. Haftarah is very good if you have someone that passed. That's the right aliyah to buy. Sometimes people buy Shvi'im Kaddish, Mashlim. That's not helping the soul. This Kaddish is not Kaddish Yatom, it's Kaddish for the Kriyat HaTorah. That's actually the last aliyah on the list is Mashlim. Best one, if there's no Kohen, is Aliyat Kohen. That's the first one to buy. If there's no Kohen, if they're a Kohen, they give it to the Kohen. Also Levi. First Aliyah is the best one if there's no Kohen in a shul. If there is Kohen, best Aliyah is Shishi, the sixth one. After that, Shlishi. Right? After that, Revi and Chamishi and Shvi'i is the same one. Same level. Fourth, fifth, and seventh, same level. Maftir, it's not an important Aliyah at all, because it's the extra one, it's not one of the seven, but for someone that passed, it's very good. Maftir, it's for Aliyat Neshama. So if someone wants to do Aliyat Neshama, Maftir, then they do Ashkava, that's the custom, okay. So they ask someone wanted Maftir, he needed Aliyat Neshama, so you have to read the Haftarah. It's very difficult to read the Haftarah, even though you have Nekudot, it's very hard words. That 99% of the Israeli who went to university do not know how to read it. Every Shabbat when I want to give maftir to Aliyah, in advance I look in the shul, who would know how to read it? And sometimes I don't find one person in the entire shul that will know how to read it. And I don't want to embarrass them, because they're going to start making mistakes. Sometimes I take this Aliyah because there's nobody here that I can give this Aliyah to read. If my brother is in a shul, he knows how to read, so I let him read. If one of the Chachamim is in a shul, I make sure that he will be maftir. Not because he needs Ilui Neshama, his parents alive, because there's nobody else that knows how to read. Sometimes you have no choice, you give him the Aliyah and somebody else read. That's also embarrassing. A Jewish person, 30, 40 years old, cannot read. It's also a problem. So what happened? They got this guy on the Aliyah. He started to read the Haftarah. And again, he started to make mistakes. This Syrian man, this old man, he was standing like this, on the bima, like this, with his thing, looking at the window like this. He doesn't even look. And he started to tell him the whole Haftarah by heart. The whole Haftarah. Very hard words from the Navi Yeshaya. He was telling him what to say without looking in a book. And he was repeating. This is the way they used to remember things when they learned. He remembered the whole Haftarah by heart. One word he missed. I was like, I cannot believe I'm seeing this. With no preparation. Just like this, by the way. Standing over there, he was the Baal Koreh. And he's telling him the whole Haftarah, what to say. And he has the book. And every word he makes a mistake. And he doesn't have a book and he tells him everything by heart. Why? This is one generation ago. That's how it used to be. One generation ago. You see, today, Baruch Hashem, there's few young rabbis in Israel. If you want to get real serious, superb Torah, you will find it in Israel. Very hard to find superb Torah out of Israel today. But in Israel, there's still very, very big top guns. There's some young rabbis, 30, 35. Their mind is like a computer. In one lecture, they can give you over 100 sources by heart. Every book, every page, where it is. Unbelievable brain. This is serious people that have matana. They have a gift from God. They have great memory. But it's not enough to have good memory. You have to have a clean mind and a clean heart and watch your eyes, not to be on the street, on the dirty streets, and look at things that destroyed your mind. And it's important what you eat. Some food makes you forget things, like olives and other things. So bottom line, there are a few rabbis. When my father passed, one young rabbi came from Natan, from Chedera, never knew about him, never saw him before. One of my assistants invited him. He doesn't only remember each page in a Gemara, he remember what line. Everything he was saying, he said, Gemara, in this page, row 18. This Gemara, row 12. This Gemara, row 7. Everything he remember, like the whole page is in front of him. Photographic memory. If you have such a gift, you learn 10 years, you know everything, basically. You never forget. Most of the learning is repeats, again and again, but you don't forget. Normal person have to repeat sometimes 100 times never to forget. Like Gemara says, 101 times. But some people, like Rav Ovadia, this is how he was. They made a joke about Rav Ovadia Yosef, Alav Shalom. Somebody came to him and said, Rabbi, I heard that you know the whole Torah by heart. He said, don't exaggerate, only half. So he said to him, which half? He said, whichever one you like. You know, they make a joke. But this is it. This is what used to be, and today is a whole different world. So let's move on. So we are entering now Parashat Beshalach, the last few parashot. First we finish the 10 plagues. We finish in Parashat Vaera, 7 plagues. And Parashat Bo, we had grasshoppers, we have darkness, and we had Makat Bechorot. We're done with the Makot. Now the nation of Israel are coming out. When they came out, the 14th day of Nisan, they prepare the Korban HaPesach. They prepare Korban HaPesach with Matzot and Maror. When did they eat it? The night. Lel HaSeder, Lel Shimurim. When did they come out? After at night, Hashem killed all the firstborns in Egypt. Early in the morning, they couldn't leave at night. They had to wait for the light. In the morning, they came out. So basically, Passover, Yom Tov, in the morning, everybody came out. And Hashem took them through the Red Sea. It's a very big mystery. If you look at the map between Israel and Egypt, you don't need to go through the Red Sea. People going now to Egypt, drive a car, you go directly to Egypt. Or you can take a bus, or whatever, you can go on a horse. You have land. You don't need to go through the Red Sea. To go through the Red Sea, it's a big circle. Go straight to Israel. Maximum 11 days walking. Walking normal. 11 days, maximum, with rest, with sleep, maximum. 11 days maximum. Could be seven days, depend, young, old. Why do you need to go, instead of going straight, you have to go from there, get into the water, Hashem has to open up the water for you. What for? The answer, this is all a part of the plan. I have to drown this Egyptian. Why do you need to drown the Egyptian? Because I want to kill them. Why I want to kill them? Because they killed you. So kill them with the lightning. When they follow us, bring lightning and they all get burned. The answer is there's one very important rule in the Torah and in life until this moment. This rule never changed and will never change. Every punishment that Hashem gives every person, Jew, non-Jew, male, female, doesn't matter, always must be measure for measure. Mida keneged mida. There's no random punishment. It's not like a secular court of Manhattan. The judge is in a bad mood, 4 years in prison. Today is in a good mood, his stock's doing well, 1 year in prison. Fine. 6 month volunteer job in a hospital. Whatever he feels like. It's not, it doesn't work like this by Hashem. Everything must be what you do, that's what you get. For good and for bad. Remember this. Everything bad happened to you in your life, that means you did it to someone else. 100%. I don't remember I did it. I live 40 years, I never did such thing to anyone. You did it in your previous life, in the life before, or the life before. You were here already a few times. You're only on a journey now. It's not the first time you're here. Your soul was in different bodies. For sure you did it. Now it came the time to pay. The Egyptian, they drowned the Jewish babies. They threw them into the water. Remember? You drown my children, I will drown you. How can I drown you? In a swimming pool? No, you come with horses. I have to take you to the Red Sea. It's all a part of the plan. It's a bait. Follow me, follow. That's what the Arabs do to the Israeli soldiers. They come close, the Israeli soldier following them, shooting tear gas, following them. Slowly, slowly they go back. As soon as the four or five soldiers go a little bit further, all the other one comes from around, begin to hit them, shoot them, humiliate them, and they don't have permission to shoot them, these monsters. Because if you shoot them, you go to jail. Because you have a liberal lefty government, traitors, sits inside the government. Instead of caring about the life and the blood of the Jews, they care about the life of these Palestinian monsters. That's what's happening today in Israel. So the soldiers is afraid. Let me just finish the army and go home. I don't want to get into trouble. That's what's happening today. This is a bait. ויהי בשלח פרעה את העם, ולא נחם אלוקים דרך ארץ פלישתים כי קרוב הוא. Why Hashem does not take them from the Philistines? Gaza. Gaza, it's between Egypt and Israel. Right away. Why you don't take us from there? Why you have to take us all the way around? כי קרוב הוא. It's very close through Gaza. Why going there in circles? Because Hashem said, if they will see the Philistines coming to fight them, they will get scared and they will return back to Egypt. I want to ask you a few questions. After Hashem made such miracles in Egypt, what is the problem of doing one more miracle and wipe out the Philistines as well? Finish the Plishtim. If they come to kill us, I'll take care of them as well. What's the problem? Do I have a problem killing Egyptians but I cannot kill the Philistines? Ze nevela ze trefa. This is a monster and this is a monster. What's the difference between them? Plus, how the Jewish people will go back to Egypt? If you tell the Jewish people who left Auschwitz and got on a boat on the way to Israel, if someone will attack them in the middle of the sea, people will come, throw rocks at them, this, they will turn around and go back to Auschwitz? Is it possible that a Jew will go back to where he suffered so many years? Who would ever want to go back to Egypt? They'll fight them and die. Or kill them, one of the two. To go back to Egypt? That's not an option. The answer is, Rabotai, remember what I said 20 minutes ago? Everything Hashem does is 100% justice. And everything He does is 100% in the right timing. The Philistines, it was not written for them on Rosh Hashanah that they have to die this year. The Egyptian, yes, Hashem judged them in Rosh Hashanah. They have a minister. Every nation has an angel that protects them. He comes to the court of heaven. Why you want to kill my people? Because they did such and such to my children. No, but they did that and they did this and they gave them a place to live. And they helped them when there was hunger. He brings all what he can say. That year, HaKadosh Baruch Hu wrote on Rosh Hashanah that in the 15th of Nisan, these 600 Egyptian carriages with the soldiers will all drown. And that's right after all the firstborns in Egypt is going to die, and Egypt will be basically destroyed and devastated. The Philistines did not have a decree. They're not supposed to die. If I take the Jewish people from their land, they come to defend their land. What's going to happen? I'm going to have to kill them. But we did not discuss this in the court. We did not discuss what we're going to do with the Philistines. I can do whatever I want. Even though I'm God, I'm the judge. I made the world with rules. And the rules are that the Satan always instigates. The Satan comes and show, he's the prosecutor. How do you let this person live? And Hashem has to find a reason why he keeps him alive. He gives reasons. The Philistines was not a part of the problem. I don't want to create another war. Let's go around. They had enough. I'm going around the Philistines. Very interesting, because Hashem took them from a far further road and forced them to go towards the Red Sea. While the Jewish people were collecting gold and jewelry from the Egyptians, one person did not walk, did not run to collect gold. Who was it? Moshe. What was he doing? He was looking for the body of Yosef that the Egyptians threw into the Nile, because they believed that the holy Yosef will bring the water up. He's a big tzaddik. Why the Egyptians threw a body of Yosef into the water and they thought that the Nile will be blessed? Where they got this idea from? That's one reason, that his father, every time he came, the water came up. But there's another reason. What's the other reason? When Yosef was alive, the Torah said that he went to work in the house of Potiphar. Potiphar was an Egyptian minister. What happened to Potiphar from the minute Yosef came to live in his house? Everything was working for him. Blessing. Hashem blessed this guy because he had a Jewish servant, 17 years old, came to his house. From the minute Yosef HaTzadik came to his house, Hashem blessed this guy in everything. Smart guy, even today, smart guy, all these billionaires, the goyim, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, all these people, they would take a Jewish yeshiva tzaddik, come work by my house, learn as much as you want Torah, just make sure you do this, you do this, you go to the bank, you know, whatever you do, give them a very nice salary, just keep you in my house, bring me blessing. We see it from the Torah. Why Hashem gave such a rasha blessing? Potiphar was a wicked person. Later he became gay. He was wicked, now wicked, baribua. Rasha baribua. Even more. And Hashem gives him blessing? A blessing is not for him. The blessing is to show you that everything in this world is for the Jewish people. Everything in this world is for the Jewish people. It's unbelievable. One Arab person sent me today a picture. I don't know how real this picture. If it's real, it's really, really unbelievable. Really unbelievable. Why it's unbelievable? You can check later on online if it's true or not. But I'll tell you what it says. It gives a list of all the big companies, all the owners and the directors of all the television stations in America. The owner of all the television stations. Maybe there was 50 stations over there. And they show who the owner is. All the owners were all Jewish. Unbelievable. How Hashem put the power of this world. You know, media runs the world. In the hand, I can't find it now, in the hand of the Jewish people. So I answer to this Arab, you are impressed how all the power in the world is in the hand of the Jews and how they control and dominate the world. But I look at it from my point of view is how these Jewish people, instead of protecting Israel and protecting their own brothers, Who are they making service for? For you, the Arabs. Everything they do is to protect you. They're all for you and they're all against Israel. So what does it help us? What does it help us that Hashem put all the media in the hand of the liberals and the lefties and the Erev Rav, that they hate Israel? That they hate the fact that they are Jewish? That they will do everything they can to hide? Some of them don't want to put mezuzot in the house because they don't want anyone when they come into the house to know they're Jewish. And they're changing their names. If his name was Steinberg, he changed it to a different name. If his name was Cohen, he changed it to a different name. Many of the Jewish people in this country, they have totally Goyish name. No one knows that they are Jewish. Only once in a while they tell the secret to someone. They think that by hiding their identity, they'll be more successful. Moshe Rabbeinu came to Tzipora in Midian, daughter of Yitro. She came to Yitro and said, an Egyptian man is here. The Chachamim say, Moshe did not do enough to show his Jewish identity. She thought he's Egyptian. That's a shame. That she had to tell her father, an Egyptian man is here. Where is Benji? Hashem surround the Jewish nation with seven clouds. Shiva anane kavod. Four from all four directions. One on top to make shed, one in the bottom to make the floor straight, and one is attached to the pillar of fire that was a divine GPS. Divine GPS that shows how to go. Imagine we had a GPS. The GPS we had today, we are so impressed. Make a right, make a left, you make a mistake, you always take you to the right direction. But the truth about this GPS, that now they sometimes take you in a longer way on purpose. They take you from direction that you will see more stores on the way. Certain stores are in their budget that when you're in that area, they're going to take you through that store that you see a big sign and you walk in. Try. Sometimes you miss the exit. Instead of the time go 5 minutes up, it goes down. Did it happen to you? It tells you get off here, you miss the exit. Now it's supposed to be longer. Up, it went down 10 minutes. It doesn't always take you, it's not 100% reliable. In Israel, it's even more dangerous. The GPS has an agenda. It's very, very liberal and lefty, the GPS. When you come from the north into Tel Aviv, on the way, it says, when you come to Baka el Garbia, an Arab village, it always tells you, make a left. Always. He's in love with Baka el Garbia. Because if you go in, you don't come out. Maybe the people of Baka el Garbia pay the money, send the Israeli to us, that we have what to do. So you cannot really rely on it. Also, when you drive in Jerusalem, it can take you to from East Jerusalem to a very dangerous neighborhood. So if you don't know, it can cost you your life. But the divine GPS is wonderful. First of all, you don't need to press button when you drive. Okay? You don't get a ticket when you put the address in. It goes in front of you and you just follow it. Imagine we had a GPS like this. You drive a car. And above you, you have a mark on the air. And whenever it goes, you follow it. It comes here, it stops, you stop. It makes it right, you follow it. You don't have to look at anything. You just look and you follow it. This is one of the clouds. One of the clouds showed them the way. Now I want to ask you a question. The first verse in the parasha, Vayi b'shalach paro et ha'am. When Paro sent the nation, I want to ask you a question. Did Paro really send the nation? Did Paro ever send the nation? If I put a gun to your head, if I come to rob you, I say, give me the money before I take the gun. No. Why should I give you money? Give me the money. No. You want to fight? Let's fight. Then I take the gun out. Once he see the gun, he gives me the money. Then I go out to my friend. I say, see what a nice guy. He gave me the money. Just gave me donation. No, you fool. He didn't give you anything. You stole from him. Did Paro really send them? Or Hashem actually sent them out? Why does it say, Vayi b'shalach Paro et ha'am? You know, there's no mistakes in the Torah. Every word in the Torah has a big, deep meaning. Why does it say that Paro sent the nation when we all know Hashem did, not him? Beautiful. Which nation we are talking here? Not the Jewish people. We're talking about the Egyptians, the Erev Rav. The Egyptian came to Moshe Rabbeinu, take us out. We don't want to stay here in Egypt. Paro said to them, shame on you, you traitors. Your nation is down now, you turn your back on your people. Get out of here, I don't want to see you. Pack your stuff and leave. These are the nation that Paro sent out. Erev Rav. How do we know? When they made the golden calf, Hashem said to Moshe, Red ki shichet amcha. Usually Hashem say, Ami, my nation, or Am Israel, the nation of Israel. Over there it say, your nation. Over here, nation, not nation of Israel. You could have said, Vayi b'shalach Paro et Israel. But Paro never sent Israel. Paro sent the Egyptians, the Erev Rav. No, so what's the problem? The Erev Rav converted. Moshe make them join Israel, no? The answer is, Rabotai, that moment is one of the most tragic moments in the history of the Jewish people. That moment that this Egyptian came out with the Jewish nation out of Egypt, until today we suffer from them. The Zohar say, in every generation they give us hard time. This Erev Rav, this Egyptian. What else? We have to know about this. In YouTube, they have a video. They found pieces of the carriages that drowned in the Red Sea. They show you the wheels, they show you parts of the carriages. 600 carriages. The amount of jewelry that the Egyptians put on the horses and on the carriages, multiplied by 600, was more wealth than what they took out of Egypt. Just try to imagine how wealthy they were. Imagine you have an army now, and you go to a war with very expensive Bentley car made from gold and diamonds. That's how they go to the war. Who goes to the war with diamonds and rubies on a carriage? This was very special ministers. They had so much money. How did they have so much money? Who made them the richest nation in history? Yosef. All the money of the world went to them. Everybody was hungry around. All the money went to them. Paro owned the entire Egypt. They didn't know what to do with the money. So they invested it in the carriages, and that's why Hashem made them chase them, that the Jews can take all these rubies and all these diamonds. Can take it out. Then it's written, Vayet Moshe et yado al hayam. Moshe picked up his hand by the ocean. Vayolech Hashem et hayam beruach kadim. Hashem made a wind from the east. Strong wind. All night. And it opened up the water into two. It splits like you have an island now in the middle. Like you're blowing air, it pushed the water to the side. Why the Torah has to tell us that the way Hashem opened the Red Sea is by sending a lot of wind? Why it's important? Just tell me you opened the Red Sea and I got the point. Why do you need to tell me you all night you send wind? The Ramban
Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, one of the biggest rabbis ever lived, and the biggest Kabbalist, 750 years ago in Barcelona, Spain. He writes that all the miracles that Hashem does, He does everything He can to cover it by the laws of nature. To cover it. That it looks like nature. Oh, wind! Wind! Look what the wind did to the water! Hashem could have opened the water without wind. Why does He need wind? Why? To hide His miracles. Why? That's the way Hashem does it. Everything in this world is hidden. Everything. There's a lot of big miracles, but there's always going to be another explanation to the miracle. Who knows why? Very good. If Hashem will not hide it, there's not going to be any more free choice. Everyone will be righteous. You see such miracles every day. How can you not be religious? The idea is that as soon as you see a miracle, right away the lefty liberal Jew will come and say, that's science. I can prove to you we can do the same thing by science. It's not only your rabbi can do it. Right away, that's what happens. You know, I don't know if you got today I got at least 30 or 40 times a message of Dr. Yeshayahu Rabinovitz. You saw that or no? With the DNA. He's a scientist. Sometimes, you know the pasuk, enayim laim velo yiru, oznayim laim velo yishmau? Sometimes it happens to us. We have eyes, but we don't see. We have ears, but we don't hear. Where my parents live, now it's my mother, it's in Rehovot. Rehovot. Downstairs, half a block, there is a big school, religious school, and over there there's a huge shul. Could put maybe 300-400 people there. Double than this big shul, double on the size. So when I go there, that's where I go to pray. Rehovot. It's called Hammer School. Hammer, that's the name, Hammer. It used to be Zvulun Hammer. In the Knesset, they named the school after him. Over there, there's a nice Argentinian man. Nice Argentinian man. Comes with his cane, beard, yarmulke, glasses, thick Argentinian accent. Between Mincha and Arvid, they do shiur mishnayot. They learn 4 or 5 mishnayot every day. Very alive. He loves Torah. I was thinking to myself, this guy is very smart, this guy. Today, 30 people sending me a big scientist from Machon Weizmann, from Weizmann Institution in Israel. One of the biggest scientists in the world, this guy. Found the stamp of God in the DNA of mankind. Who is this scientist? This guy sit next to me in a shul. I'm talking to him. Again and again, and I didn't realize it's him. All of a sudden, I said, I can't believe this is him. So humble. You don't even know he's one of the biggest scientists. Investigate DNA. You know what he found? You're not going to believe it. For those who still can't dare to say that they are atheists, I hope this is going to block their mouth for good. He found that in the DNA, you know, there are not two people with the same DNA, right? There is bridges, you know, the DNA goes like a spiral like this. There are bridges that holds the DNA. Hold it, that it won't fall apart. It's like an arm, like a half a circle. Holdings. Do you know the pattern of these bridges? One has 10, the next one has 5, the next one has 6, and the next one has 5. And again, 10, 5, 6, 5. 10, 5, 6, 5. What is it? Yud-Kei Vav-Kei. The name of Hashem in our DNA.
like the artist that put a paint a picture, stamping his stamp always on a picture, it brings the price 100 times more once you put his name on it. In the DNA of the people, Yud Kei Vav Kei, the name of Hashem. Huh? Goyim, Goyim are not made by Hashem. I wonder if by animals is also like that. I would not be surprised. Maybe by animals also. Everything Hashem did. Hashem put, Hashem is the artist of everything. Everything. Even animals, there's mitzvah in the Torah to not to torture animals, not allowed to kill them for no reason. You have to feed them, you have to take care of them, you cannot torture them. It's a lot of rules by when it comes to animals. ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. Time is running out. The nation of Israel, they had 10 miracles that Hashem did to them in the Red Sea. 10 miracles. Remember, each one of you were there. Each one of you. Not in this physical body, but in a different body. But we were all there, and we were all in Mount Sinai, if we are Jewish. Today, nobody knows if he's Jewish or not. You don't know if you're Jewish or not. How do you know? You only know you're Jewish, it goes by chazakah. You know what chazakah means? You go by certainty. Certainty. My father is Jewish. Yes, that's what he believed. His father is Jewish. Yeah, his father is Jewish. Yeah, my mother is Jewish. Her mother, three generations, I'm Jewish. Chazakah. Can you swear with your life that you're Jewish? No. Nobody knows for sure. Maybe 10 generations ago in Russia, your grandmother was a Goya. And your grandfather of your grandfather of your grandfather smuggled her into the tribe in Uzbekistan. Everyone looked like Jews back then. Everyone was modest. Smuggled her into the tribe and married her. And your grandmother was Goya, who gave birth to Goya, all the way to your mother. And you're sure you're Jewish. There's no way to know. But I have news for you. I have very big news for you. There is now a machine that detects the aura, the color of the aura of the of a human being. Detect the color of the aura. When I look at you, I cannot see any colors. This machine, that costs a few thousand dollars, a sophisticated device, and connected to a person, and it shows the colors around the head and around the body in certain places, all the way from purple, green, white, all different colors. Some colors are bad, some colors are average, some colors are very good. Huh? It's colors that your eyes cannot see, but the machine shows you. On a screen, you look at your image. So they made few experiments with this machine. They took Rav Mordechai Eliyahu, Alav HaShalom, was one of the holiest rabbis in Israel until 15 years ago he was alive. And they told him to put tefillin on. He had an average color before he puts the tefillin on. As soon as he put the tefillin on, the color all changed into bright white. When he took off the tefillin, the other color came back. Then he said to him, Rabbi, you're a Kabbalist. When I signal to you, you will do Kavanah, some Kabbalistic intention in your mind, special Kavanah. Kabbalistic thinking of the names of Hashem. Once I signal to you, when Rav Mordechai Eliyahu was making Yichudim in his mind, the color changed completely to the most pure color. But they did some other test, and some people, their tefillin is not kosher. it does not change the color at all. So we already found a way to check if your tefillin is kosher or not. You go over there, it costs, I think, $30-something to go into that person. So now, my friend, I had a Shabbaton by my house now. Lots of guys came from Atlanta. They're still there. They go to the Shiva every day. They get a taste of what Monsi is. So yesterday in the morning, the guy that organized the Shabbaton, I worked with him for over 20 years in Kyiv. So he said to me that he went to do this check, and the goy that was in charge of the machine, the goy said to him, what is this box when you put all the color change to positive? He said to him, this is tefillin from God and this. He said, I also want to put. So he said, okay, come, put it on. And he said that even the color of the goy changed to positive. So he asked the goy, tell me, you have anyone Jewish in your family? He said, no, we're not Jewish, but only my grandmother was Jewish. So he said to him, which grandmother? He said, my mother's mother. Through this check, the goy found out he's a Jew. So if you put this tefillin on a non-Jew, it will not make any difference. So now if you want to know if you're Jewish or not, all you have to do is to go to this check, pay $35, take tefillin that are for sure kosher, that work on someone else, you put it on. If all the colors change to bright white, then you know you're Jewish. If it does not change, it gadal v'itkadash merabah. Very easy. When I was in Tzfat, all the way in the north of Israel, one woman and her son were begging me to go to do that test. The problem is I didn't have time. I finished my lecture, it was late at night, and from Tzfat all the way to Rehovot, it's like 2-3 hours ride. When will I get home? I'm going to go at 10:30 at night for someone's house to do the test? But now something for the ladies to upset them. When the ladies put kisui rosh, cover, it changed everything to the most pure color. When they put the wig, Hashem Yirachem, I don't want to continue the sentence. Now there are two possibilities. One, that maybe wigs altogether are not kosher. Hashem is not happy from it. That's one option. Like Rav Ovadia Yosef say, and some other poskim. But I don't so much believe in it, because if the Gdolei Torah allowed it, Hashem has to take this to consideration, because this is the way the Torah is. So what's the other option? Why it's a negative color? Because almost all these wigs come from idol worshippers in India. All the hair they sacrifice to the statues of India. The Indian women that shave their head, they have nothing to offer. They don't have money. So they shave their head, they become bald, and they bring all the hair. And Indian hair is known as the best hair in the world for a woman. Thick, strong, does not get ripped in the middle, and it's the easiest one to use for wig. And don't be confused that the wig is red and blonde. They dye it, of course. You don't need to dye it every month, because it doesn't grow. Once you dye it blonde, it stays blonde for 10 years. The problem is that you cover your neshama with avodah zarah. That's the problem. Sensitive issue, all these wigs. A lot of fights go over it. Definitely, a smart woman that has a strong power of will should do everything she can not to use wigs, to cover her hair fully. Not necessarily with mitpacha, they can put a hat, there's all kinds of nice hats today. Okay, anything that is not a wig can be very good as long as you don't have hair coming out. 10 miracles happened to our father on the Red Sea. The water split, the water became like a tent, like a tunnel. What else? The floor, the land, became dry, not sticky and muddy. So the animals could walk, and they could walk. Imagine if it would be all mud. You get stuck, you cannot pick up your leg. When the Egyptian came, when the Egyptian came, it was muddy for them, and they got stuck. So for us, it was fine. For them, it was very sticky. The water that surrounded them in the ocean was not one piece, was pieces, like bricks that are one on top of the other. That's how Hashem made it. The water on the side were hard like a rock, like a chunk of big ice. The water split to how many channels? 12. Why? Each tribe went separately. Each tribe. Kol shevet baderech echad levado. I wonder, all the other ones is perfectly understood, but why did Hashem care if each tribe will go separately or they all go together? What was the problem? Why did he need to make the miracle much bigger that each tribe will go separately? Why? Fast? So he would divide them regardless of tribes. Make 12 paths. Yeah. 8% of you go here, 8% here. Regardless of tribes. Yalla, no, you go here, you go. Everyone, like you go in the supermarket, you have eyes, you check which one has the short line. Automatically, it balances itself out. What do you need to go by the tribes? I think, remember, back then it was not permitted to marry each other, the tribes. Why? We did not divide the land yet. We have to divide the land based on tribes. Each tribe, based on a blessing that he got from Yaakov and Hashem, he has to get a piece of land in Israel. If they will all get mixed, there will be only one mixed tribe. There's not going to be 12 tribes anymore. So only after they divided by the men, by the family of the men, Shevet Levi got many cities, all the other tribe got a piece of land. Now, after that, it's no problem. You want to get mixed? No problem. Tu Be'av is one of the miracles there that Hashem allowed the tribes to go and marry each other because it was not relevant anymore. Today, we still have this separation. Every nationality wants to marry their own people. Persian, once Persian. Syrian, once Syrian. Bukharian, once Bukharian. You come to Bukharian and say, I have a great Kafkazi girl. No, no, I want only Bukharian. Why Kafkazi? She also speaks Russian. She also makes rice. You know, more or less the same area. Same genes. It's from the same area. No! You go, and the best part is, that each nation think they are the best. Huh? You connect everyone to a lie detector. Who do you think from all the Edot, it's nationality, is the best one? Everybody say we. No? What does it lead to? It leads to separation. I give you an example. There is the Mashhadi Persian Jews, Mashhad. They came from the city of Mashhad. Mashhadim, Iranian, Mashhadi. They are not mixing with other Iranians. If someone from Tehran and someone from Mashhad met, where are you from? Tehran. Tehruni. Go back to Ahmadinejad. You cannot marry me, I'm Mashhadi. Someone told me that finally it's changing now. But until now, for over 100 years, they did not want to marry anyone else besides their own people, meaning people that came from the city of Mashhad. I was very surprised to hear such thing. After all, they're all Persian. You know? And then they explained to me that the people of Mashhad, they were very religious, and the Muslims abused them big time, and none of the other Persians came for their help. So it's like they swore that they don't want anything to do with them. But all these kinds of vows that people do, after 100 years, you still want to keep it. What is the fault of the Persians today that the grandparents 150 years ago in Iran did not go to help to the Jews of Mashhad? What is it their fault? After all, it's the same culture, same language. You have a good shidduch, you rather stay single. Every man that stays single a minute after he was offered a good shidduch by a good righteous girl, modest, with Yirat Shamayim, and he likes how she looks, and he did not take her because of her nationality, every second now of his life is a crime, for the rest of his life. Because first of all, he stays without a woman, so he makes sins. He thinks, he looks at other women, it's very hard for him, he's alone, wasting seed, thinking not clean thoughts. All of that could have been prevented, and by now he would have kids. But not only that, there is an obligation in the Torah to get married and to have children, and until you have a boy and a girl, you cannot rest. You have to do everything you can to try. Once you have a boy and a girl, okay, you can take it a little bit easier. But you must have at least a boy and a girl. And this is an obligation for the man, not for the woman. The woman is not obligated to get married. She said, you know what? I don't want to serve a man. I don't want to cook dinner. I don't want to make ashpolo. I don't want to make osvot for Shabbat. I don't want to clean the bathroom. I don't want to clean the house. And I don't want a man to scream at me all day. Why there's no hot meal when I come home? You know what I really want? I want to learn Gemara all my life. Can you stop her or no? She's not actually making a scene. She wants to learn Gemara. She goes sit herself with Gemara, she enjoy. Learn Chumash, Mishnah, Gemara. All her life. Never got married. Maybe Hashem will be angry at her. Why you did not go and gather together with another man, giving him a chance to have mitzvah pruvu? Yes, because the women, after all, it's an assistance to the men. But personally, she can answer, I don't have mitzvah pruvu. I'm not a man. I want to learn Torah. I know a few women, by the way, that they are addicted to Torah. They cannot stop learning. Maybe they are gilgulim of some great rabbis, I don't know. They can't stop learning. I remember I used to teach in Midrashiyah many years ago in Brooklyn. There was one girl, she was very, very smart girl. She was Baalat Tshuva, believe it or not. But classy, very smart, very sharp, righteous. You can see very fine quality. So she asked, can I learn Gemara? I say, no, it's not good. The Gemara says women should not learn Gemara. Why the Chachamim in the Gemara are worried that women would learn Gemara? Because women are not smart? No, they're very smart. If she can be a professor for math, or a scientist, or a doctor, she can also learn Gemara. So why the Chachamim were worried that women would start sitting in yeshivot and learn Gemara? Because it's addictive. Then you cannot live without it. If you're married and you have children and you are in the middle of sugiya, you can learn for 4 hours with forgetting the world. The kid can die in the meantime, in his diaper, or in a shower, drowning. And you're not exist in this world. Mamash like this, like Chacham Ovadia Yosef. Bibi Netanyahu was standing next to him for half an hour with all his bodyguards and the walkie-talkie. And he did not realize that the Prime Minister of Israel stand one step away from his chair. He did not realize. He was so deep into their books. When one of the rabbis that came to speak in my father's Shiva, his name is Almog Levi. He's from Modi'in. I spoke once in his shul. He was like Ben Bait in the house of Rav Ovadia Yosef. Rav Yitzchak Yosef used to be his rabbi. He used to send him to bring books from his father's house. So he used to go to Rav Ovadia's room in the middle of the day when no one was there. and ask him, your son, Rabbi Yitzchak, wants this, this, and this book, and this book. So he was saying how he liked him when he used to come, they used to talk, give him some smacks. So he said that in the beginning, he didn't know what to do. He walked into his room. He stands there 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. He doesn't see that he's there. It's in a different world. He moved the chair. Nothing. Only when he had to touch him. Kvod Harav, Amir, I came to take books. And the interesting thing that he has 40, some say 70,000 books in his house. And every time he was telling him the books, he would tell him what room, what shelf, what floor, and what number. Everything was in his head. And he said that all the books, tens of thousands of books, all of them are full of his handwriting. Do you know what it means or no? What does it mean? That his son, Rabbi Moshe Yosef, that has now 40,000 books, each one of them eventually will be over $1 million. You do the math. 40,000 times a million. How much is that? Huh? No, who knows math? 400 billion. Where is Bill Gates and Putin and Gaddafi? Where are they? Huh? Just the value of the books. With the original handwriting. One book of the Chatam Sofer from 200 years ago. One Ashkenazi man in Israel owned it with his handwriting. He sold it for $1.4 million. And guess what? The person that bought it that day, that week, doubled his money. How? He broke it into pages. And he sold each page, and that was exactly double, 2.8 million. It's a lot of business in this Judaica. Huh? Just like our books, Rabbi Golan. Huh? 2.8 million. Baruch Hashem. Maybe one day we'll work something. But this is handwriting. Once it's printed, it's already nothing special. No, what else? So, the separation between tribe to tribe was like glass, that they all see each other. They see how my neighbor's progressing, that I can go faster or slower. And they also see the pillar of fire through the glass. Clear glass, like mamash, like a glass. And every few steps, there were like a faucet. Some of the water coming out of the wall. Like you can come and put your mouth and drink, like in the airport. You press the button, very good. Today in America, if you drink from tap water, people already look at you as like you're a criminal or some kind of a crazy guy. Maybe you need an appointment with a psychiatrist. What? You drink from the faucet? Shem Yerachem. Pikuach nefesh. Vayavo marata velo yachlu lishtot mayim. They came to a place, mara. Mara means bitter. Mar. Mar means bitter. They cannot drink water. Hashem said to Moshe, take a piece of tree, throw into the water. What's the tree has to do with making the water sweet? If my tea now is bitter, there's no sugar in it, and I'll take a piece of this wood, I break it now, and I put it in a tea, it's going to make it sweet? I take tree from the street, it's going to make it sweet? What's the tree has to do with that? No? Huh? The answer is to minimize the miracle. I'm doing something. I can go like this, and the water becomes sweet. But that's already a big miracle. Throw something in. Oh, now the scientists have what to say. Oh, you know what happened? The molecules of the trees, when they go in 35 degrees in the middle of the day, in this kind of temperature, it's causing something in the law of physics. Well, I mean, what are they going to sell? You know, they have to sell something, no? I want to tell you something interesting. You know, water, when you heat water, they expand or they shrink? Huh? Expand. When you heat water, they expand. When you cool water, they shrink until they become ice. So now, when the temperature drop, 32 degrees Fahrenheit is 0 degrees Celsius. 0 degrees Celsius, that means now it turns into freezing. Up to zero, it's still liquid. When it gets to zero and below, -1, -2, it becomes ice. In America, you don't have zero. There's always strange numbers in America. So 32, it's the zero. Okay. So if it goes to 25, it's like -3, -4. So it's going to become ice. As you can see outside, water in your driveway, they become ice. What happened in the ocean now? The frozen temperature make the top of the river or the lake all ice. People walk over there. You can drive a car on it. Sometimes it's 10 meters, 30 feet thick. You have nothing to worry about. Such big ice is better than cement. I saw some movies that people actually mamash drive on the ice. I saw in one of the books that in Italy, it's also like that, very cold. In the morning, the Ramchal used to walk on the ice and take a stick, make a hole in the ice, and go into the mikveh. Imagine pieces of ice until he became deaf in one ear from the cold temperature. Early in the morning, mikveh. So imagine something interesting. The water, what happened to the water when they get to 4 degrees Celsius? They're going close to the frozen temperature. The more you cool them, the more they shrink and become more concentrate. Once they get to 4 degrees, they turn around 180 degrees and they begin to expand. It's very interesting. Why? It's against the law of nature. The law of nature, the more you cool it, the more it's going to react. The more you heat it, the more it's going to react. With the same transaction, you cannot reach one thing and the opposite thing at the same time. It's against the law of nature. There's only one problem. If the water would continue to behave the same, 4 degrees, 3 degrees, 2 degrees, 1 degree, you know what would happen? The top layer of the ocean will become a chunk of ice. Then they would sink to the bottom. They would sink all the way to the bottom of the ocean. And then the top will freeze and sink to the bottom. And then the top would freeze and sink to the bottom. After a week, all the water in the world will become one piece of ice. All the fish would freeze and die. Nothing will be left in the water. And then when the summer comes, everything will defrost in one shot. 100 degrees, 110 degrees, everything will defrost in one shot and flood the whole world and everyone will die. So Hashem had no choice. He needed to interfere with the laws of nature and make an adjustment. Why? If people want to live, I better do it. I give you another example. Some people say, you ask them, who made the world? I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? A person could make the world? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe. A person can build the world? How he built the stars? How he put them in space? How he picked it up? I don't know. Don't ask me hard question. There's two options here. Either this guy is a total brainless, or he's a sneaky guy. Which one of the two you think is more accurate? Huh? He's a sneaky guy. Why the snake is answering, I don't know. Why it's so hard for him to say, of course, God made the world. There has to be a superpower that made such a creation. Why is people are so afraid to say it? Why? Huh? It's similar to a relationship between an American guy and an American girl. Steve met Christine. They are dating now 3 months. Every day, meetings, dinners. And her friends ask her, Christine, did he tell you he loves you already? Not yet. Did you tell him? Not yet. Do you love him? I don't know yet. Do you love her? I don't know yet. I have feelings, but they're afraid to say the word, I love you. Why? Because once you say it, it's a commitment. People do not like to commit. Same thing when a person says, yeah, God made the world, immediately he committed himself to this God. The next thing you're going to tell him, shame on you, you loser. You live in a lie like this. Look at your life. Like a clown. Everything in your life is a mess, no direction, you don't follow instructions, you rebel against your creator, such an ungrateful beast you are. Shame on you. Person feel horrible. Because he know it's true. So people found a psychological trick. I don't know. I'm a moron. I don't know. Leave me alone. Huh? Yeah. So I'll tell you something. Do you know the size of space? Some scientists say it's endless. Some say, well, nobody ever reached the end of space. What's going to be? If you fly in a spaceship, fly, fly, fly. If space will end, what will be behind it? When do you come to the end of space? What's going to happen? It has to be another space. What's going to be? A wall? So I heard a beautiful explanation by one scientist that the world, the space is in a size, in the shape of the number 8. That's the shape of it. 8 is like eternity. You continue to go straight and straight and straight. You're always going that shape. There's never going to be an end. Like a circle. Similar like a circle. So now space is huge, huge. You fly for years with a spaceship and you're never going to finish this whole thing. Billions of galaxies, trillions. Our Earth, it's similar to taking a little dime, and throw it in the ocean. The dime compared to the ocean, it takes even more space than what Earth takes in space. The dime. Take more space in the ocean than what our world takes in the entire universe. Now it's very interesting because our world could have been placed only in one place in order for us to live here, not to freeze to death and not to burn alive in 1 second. We needed to be placed in one place in space, and in every other place that Hashem would place our world, we will all die in a minute. In a second, not in a minute. And guess what? From all the trillions and 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 trillions until next year, trillions of possibilities, the only one possibility that it's suitable for life of human being and an animal, that's where the Earth was placed. You take it further away from the sun, will freeze immediately. You move it 5% towards the sun or 2%, temperature will go to 1,000 degrees. We wouldn't be able to live. Where Earth has to be, exactly where it is. All the other places cannot live. And it stands in space, does not fall down, roll around itself, rotate, 1,700 kilometers per hour, about 1,100 miles around its own center, rotate.
and at the same time moves around the space, around the sun, in 1 year, 365 days, one circle. And at the same time, the moon rotates around the earth as they both move around the sun. But that's only three stars, earth, moon, and sun. There are trillions of stars like this who rotate around each other, and none of them hit each other. Do you know what would happen? If Earth and another star one day will come to the same area and hit each other while they're still rotating, do you know what would happen? It's like 5 million nuclear bombs in 1 second. I don't have to tell you what's going to be with us. But the best part is that every second there are millions of meteors falling. Pieces from other stars are breaking, some of them size of New Jersey, size of Israel, falling into space. Imagine a country like the size of Israel would detach from one star and hit our world. What would happen here? Fallen Manhattan, imagine this. Even fly next to us, 10 miles away, the wind that it's going to make will shake the whole world. Buildings will fall, all of us would fall on the floor, waters would flood the whole area, if it comes even near. Don't forget, it's magnetic fields and atmosphere and all these kinds of things. Who knows what would happen? Every 3 seconds, a piece from another star hits the earth. So why you don't feel it? Because Hashem made us atmosphere. The atmosphere grinds it. Special protection. Special shield. Every 3 seconds, rain of meteors. If you look at the space, like lines of fire. Every 3 seconds, like this. All you need, that the piece, some of the pieces is the size of this table, big pieces like this. If they kind of, if a piece like this, size of a refrigerator, would fall, if there was no atmosphere, and it would fall in Manhattan on a building, with such speed, it's gonna break 10 floors. It's gonna, can make a big explosion, it can fall on the gas pipes. It can create a disaster, a small piece. Every 3 seconds, a piece like this come to us. And the atmosphere keep grinding it, grinding it. But two times, the piece was so big that the atmosphere could not handle it. And they hit the earth. One in Siberia, 1904, middle of the desert of ice. Hundreds of miles of ice. In the middle of nowhere that nobody can live there. Boom, it hit over there. 60 miles away, people fell on the floor. And the second time in America, where is it, Grand Canyon over there, Arizona. Baruch Hashem, that's before the Bukharians were there. If now the Bukharians' holiness protect the area, Baruch Hashem. That's when all the cowboys there, you know. Clint Eastwood and his friends in the desert of Arizona, Hashem sent them something on their head. It made a huge hole in the ground, 17 kilometers, size of Manhattan, all the way from Harlem to Wall Street. Imagine if it would fall on Manhattan. It would knock down 10,000 buildings. 20 million people would die. It would be the end of the world. The markets would crash, everything. Imagine this, Rabotai. But it fell twice in a place that nobody lives. Coincidence? Hashem wanted to show us what we are getting safe from. But nobody wakes up. How is it possible to find doctors that open the body of people, of patients every day? See how the heart pumping, how the lung functioning, the liver, the nerve system, everything, all the vessels, everything, the valves. They see how this whole operation works together in such harmony, and they are not shocked
by the brilliance of Hashem, and how is it possible? Yet, 2 minutes later, he goes to lunch and eats pork. Dr. Goldstein, didn't you just operate on someone's heart and you saw the wonders of Hashem? How you sit now and behave like a goy? I'm an atheist. I don't believe. I told you once and I'll tell you again, Rabotai. If someone tells you he's an atheist, don't believe him. There's no such thing. No one in the world is an atheist. No one. Not even one person. You don't believe me? Bring them to me. We connect them to a lie detector. We'll ask them, do you believe that someone made this world, or you think the world was made by a random explosion? They all will be forced to answer that they believe that someone made the world, just like they believe that someone printed the book, and just like they believe that someone made this stand, and just that they believe that someone made this plastic bottle with all the lines and everything. If they would say that they don't believe in something like that, then you know they're crazy. Right or wrong? Would you like a partner that claimed that this bottle was made by an explosion? Would you want him to be your partner in business? Would you or no? Huh? Would you want him to be your teacher? Yes or no? Someone that said that this bottle was made by an explosion in a garbage can. Psh! Sticker came, all the letters, the lead, all the lines, the parallel lines, everything came into place by itself. If that's what he say, you want him to be your teacher? Yes or no? Who wants him to be your teacher? Someone say yes, I think. Huh? No? Was a joke? So why you go to colleges? Huh? You see, all of you live in a lie. I tricked you. All of you said, no, of course, I don't want such a moron teacher that tells me that this was made by an explosion. But what do you think you learn in colleges? What do you think? What did they teach about the Big Bang and many attempts? Psh, psh. One of them worked out. And you, professor, yes, can you sign my book? Instead of putting this professor in a garbage can, and I don't want to tell you what you should dump on his head. Professor, it's such an honor to be in your class. Oh, my pleasure. What is this book? For retarded people. That's what it is. And it was a random explosion many times until, where is all the debris? When usually there's explosion, it leaves debris, no? If there were millions of explosions, like they say, where is all the debris? Half of it. After many attempts. It should have debris somewhere, no? Half of it, where nobody ever found it. Any questions before we finish? Huh? One last thing that we understand, it's very important. When the nation of Israel arrived to the water actually did not open up. I don't have to tell you the level of panicking that they had. They see the Egyptians are chasing them. They have babies, kids. Imagine a mother, she has 10 kids, she's holding them, and she sees these monsters, Nazis, coming after 210 years living by them, 83 years of tortures in slavery. In 5 minutes, they will reach our place and kill us all. I don't want to go back to Auschwitz. So they all started to scream and to cry. Normal or not? Normal reaction or no? So why Hashem got so angry? The Satan comes to Hashem and said, don't dare to split the Red Sea. It's not fair. Objection, Your Honor. Why objection? The Jews are nothing better than these Egyptians. Let's face it. Halalu of the Avodah Zarah, they are idol worshippers, and they are our idol worshippers. Hashem said, why the Jews are idol worshippers? Because after everything you did for them, after all the miracles, after what you did to the Egyptian, after you promised them that you take them out of Egypt, they still doubt you. Their brain cannot overcome their heart. How are you going to make a miracle for them? At that time, what was Moshe doing? What was Moshe doing? Praying, screaming to Hashem. What did Hashem say to Moshe? Mati tzak elai, why are you screaming to me now? Daber al bnei Israel ve'isau. Talk to the Jewish nation that they should move in, into the water. This conversation, if you don't really understand it, you miss the point. Very important for our life. Because remember, everything we know from the Torah. Everything. About what Hashem does, how He looks at us, how we're going to be good and how we're going to be bad. Everything comes from the Torah. We know from the Torah what Hashem loves, what He hates, and how the world operates. When Moshe screamed to Hashem, Hashem should have said to him, why only you screaming to me? Go gather a lot of minyanim to pray. That's not what Hashem said. He said to Moshe, there's no time to scream and to pray right now. You have to do something. Action. Action required. Why? What can be better than praying? The Gemara says, I wish a person would pray all day. You don't make sins. You connect to Hashem. When you talk to Hashem, you connect to Hashem. Conversation make connection. Connection. The answer is because the Satan has a claim and I don't know what to say. He has a good point. The Satan objects. I cannot open the water. Why? Because look at them. Look how everybody is crying here, doubting me after so much I've done for them. He stopped the whole process. In 5 more minutes, there's not going to be a Tziat Mitzrayim. All of you are going to die. The whole Torah will be dismissed and canceled. No one will ever get the Torah. All the plan is all destroyed. Why? The Satan has a claim, and I am the God of justice. I cannot do whatever I like. I'm limited to my rules. He is the prosecutor. He said, why would you open the Red Sea for idol worshippers while you're killing the other idol worshippers? Where is your justice? What am I going to say? So he said to Moshe, there's no time now. Quickly, move into the water. Once you move into the water, right away I come back to the Satan and I dismiss his claim. How can you call them idol worshippers? They went into the water reached their nose, they're willing to die, they count on me. When Nachshon went into the water and the water reached his nose, that's when it opened up. They would not go in, that would be the end of us. We would not be sitting here now. There would not be a world. Because the whole world is for the Jewish people, as the Torah say. There will not be any more Jewish people. 80% died in Makat Choshech, 12 million died. 3 more million would die now, and that would be the end of it. That's it. And there's nothing Hashem could have done about it, Rabotai. This was mamash, the closest moment for annihilation. How do you call it? Annihilation. The closest moment from total annihilation that we ever been in. Another few minutes and we will not be here anymore. So technically, Nachshon ben Aminadav saved the entire Jewish nation. And you know what's the interesting part? That his brother is the one who had the idea. But Nachshon is the one who did it. And he got the credit. Idea is not enough. His brother said we should go into the water and trust Hashem. That's what he's expecting from us. And who did it in the end? Nachshon. His brother didn't get to do what he planned. Many times, the Gemara says in Masechet Baba Metzia, Shnayim ochazin betalit, two people holding an item. Zo omer, kula sheli. This guy says it's all mine. This guy says it's all mine. זה אומר אני מצאתיה, זה אומר אני מצאתיה. This guy say I found it, this guy say I found it. Meaning, whoever found it first, whoever grabbed it first, that's his. Now the Gemara asks, what happened if Reuven saw it and Shimon went and get it? Like meaning, Reuven and Shimon walks in the street, Reuven see a diamond ring on the floor. Shimon, look, diamond ring. He walks to get it, Shimon jumped, grabbed it. Who got it? The one who grabbed it, not the one who saw it first. You understand, Rabotai? He had a great idea, but who in the end got the credit? The one who actually did it. In business is the same thing. How many people talk, they have great ideas. One person heard you speaking and went and opened a business, became multi-billionaire. Hey, it was my idea. Too bad. You had all the time to do it. Why didn't you do it? That's what's happened. One last thing, Mamash, we have 2 minutes left. Many people ask today, I get this question all the time, I'm sure you hear about it all the time. How come today Hashem does not do miracles like He did back then? Why don't we see the same amount of miracles? GPS, the ground becomes straight, 10 plagues, Red Sea splits, very big miracles. Why don't we see miracles like this today? We know there's a lot of miracles today, but they're all hidden. How come? The answer is, Rabotai, please don't forget that. We're very lucky that we don't have the same miracles today. Baruch Hashem, we're very lucky. But you know what would happen if we would have the same miracles today? Every time we commit a sin, 20, 30,000 of us would fall and die. Look at the 40 years in the desert. While they're having miracles by Hashem, every sin, one sin, 24,000 dead. One sin, 14,700 died. One sin, 3,000 died. In all the wars with Israel and the Arabs in the last 70 years, since we became state, so many wars, so many terror attacks, almost 24,000 soldiers died and other civilians in war with Arabs and terrorist attack. 24,000. One sin in the Torah, 24,000 died. One sin. Another one, 14,700. When you get clear miracles and you still dare to sin, the price is tremendous. Sins are not for free. What do you think? I'm going to serve you and do everything for you and you're still going to commit sins? And I let it go? You see me in your eyes and you dare to rebel against me? I'm doing you a big favor that I'm hiding myself in nature. That I cover my miracles. Because if the miracles would be just like the opening of the Red Sea, and a minute later you speak Lashon Hara, do you know how many people would die that day? If someone would dare to be Mechalel Shabbat. People that did not want to come out of Egypt. They didn't say we don't believe in Hashem. They didn't say we don't appreciate Hashem. They didn't say we don't love Hashem. They only say, we want to stay here. That's it. We suffered enough. 83 years in a ghetto and suffering in slavery. Give us some break. We are not now built to go into a journey into the desert. We're not in a mood for this now. Yeah, let us go back to our homes, save what we can. We don't want. That's their crime was. That's it. 12 million of them died in 3 days. 12 million. Only 20% came out. 80% died because after what you saw, you still want to stay in this filthy place when you know we're heading to receive my Torah and to take you to the Holy Land? I'm about to give you the most precious thing I made, is the Torah. And you're talking to me about staying in Egypt, buying some real estate, working in 47th Street, opening a pharmacy, being a pharmacist. Huh? That's what you want, selling gold teeth to the black rappers in Miami and watches with gold. That's what you want, huh? I want to take you to Beit HaMikdash and you want to stay in South Beach or in the village or in San Francisco. What do I need you for? Don't ever forget that we have a verse that we say three times a day. Ani Hashem Elokechem Asher Otzeti Etchem Me'eretz Mitzrayim. I am the God that took you out of Egypt. All of us focus on the first half of the sentence. I am the God that took you out of Egypt. The second part of the verse is much more important. Nobody pays attention to it. I realized. Liot lachem le'elokim. The only reason I took you out of Egypt is to be your God. Not that you be a goy living in Manhattan or in San Francisco. For that I will never save you. What do you think? I save you from your beautiful eyes? For your nice earring? For your jeans with the holes? For the tattoos you make and the ponytail? And the goya you married? And the customers that you cheat in a business? For that I took you out of Egypt? So that's a very serious obligation. That's a very serious obligation. The Gemara said one woman fell into a pit. She was deep in the ground. One man came. She said, save me. I'm dying. Save me. He asked her, if I save you, will you marry me? There's only one chance. If you want me to save you, you promise to marry me. She said, okay. So who's going to be our witnesses? He said, Pete is one witness. And there was a big rat over there. Big rat, Hulda. That's the second witness. Took her out. Everybody went to his direction. Then after that, they forgot about each other. Each one went and got married. Their children are dying. One fell into the pit. One, the rat came and beat that kid. What's going on here? I took you out of the pit for one condition, that you should marry me, not someone else. You betrayed me. The pit and the mouse and the rat came to take revenge. All the time Hashem said, I put heaven and earth to be the witnesses for the covenant that I made with you. Why heaven and earth? They will always be around. Everything else today is here, tomorrow it's in a grave. Heaven and earth will always be around. Those are my two witnesses. That's it, Rabotai. Remember, please, next Monday and the following two Mondays, three Mondays in a row now, there's no lecture. We'll be back mid-February, Bezrat Hashem. In Brooklyn, February 5th, I will be back to give the first lecture over there on Tuesday night. And also tomorrow night I'll speak in Brooklyn. Then Wednesday I'm flying to Israel, Bezrat Hashem. Don't forget that this lecture was Leilui Nishmat Gabriel Ben Shirin, Amnon Ben Sio, and David Ben Yosef. Baruch Adonai Leolam, Amen Ve'Amen. Rabbi Hananiah Ben Akashia Omer, Ratzak.